Okay, wait. So let me see if I can echo some of that back. So it's almost as if what we're doing here is we're doing a transformation into a new space where feature selection can work.
Exactly. And in fact, here's something kind of interesting for you. It turns out that if the eigenvalue of some particular dimension is equal to zero, then it means it provides no information whatsoever in the original space. So if I have a direction, if I have a dimension that has an eigenvalue of zero, I can throw it away and it will not affect my reconstruction error.
I'm trying to remember if that makes it irrelevant or useless.
Well, it certainly makes it irrelevant. If there's no variance, that's the same thing as saying it has zero entropy because it never changes. So it's irrelevant. Now, whether it's useful or not, well, probably not, but it might be useful for something like our simple perceptron example that we used last time.
Gotcha.
Okay, so does this all make sense?
So one question I have is in the example that we just kind of worked through, there was a blob of data, and when we drew the red line through the maximum variance direction, it went through the XY origin. Does it have to? Is it necessarily the case that it's going to, or is the algorithm restricted to have to put things through the origin?
Well, so my answer to you is that that's actually a very complicated question. And in principle, so to speak, it doesn't really matter. But in practice, what people do when they're doing something like PCA is they actually subtract the mean of the data or the centroid of the data from all the data points. So it ends up being centered around an origin or the origin. I mean, what this means is that you can then interpret what we're doing as finding maximal variance as capturing correlation.
Okay, that's helpful.
Otherwise, if you don't do that, what you end up with is effectively a principal component that at least intuitively kind of captures the notion of where the origin should be, and it's not terribly helpful for what it is we're trying to do. So my answer is no, it doesn't, and yes, it does. Okay? Okay, so that's basically PCA. It's got all these neat properties. Let's sort of summarize them again. It's, well, actually, let me add a couple beyond these. It is a global algorithm. It does give you best reconstruction error, which seems like a very nice thing to have. And it tells you which of the new features that you get out are actually important with respect to this notion of reconstruction by simply looking at their corresponding eigenvalues. They also have a couple of other practical properties. In particular, it's very well studied. And what that means in this case is that there are very fast algorithms that do a very good job, even in weird cases, even with large data sets, at least if they're appropriately sparse, of being able to compute these things quickly. People have been working on this problem, again, since before we were born, Michael, and they've gotten really good at finding principal components, even for what would be very difficult spaces. But this does lead me to a question, though, which is another practical question, which is, okay, so you've got an algorithm that provably gives you the best reconstruction, but what does it have to do with classification? So this is kind of like the question we had before about relevance versus usefulness. So we find a bunch of projections which are relevant in the sense that they allow you to do reconstruction, but it's not clear that if you threw away some of these projections, the ones with low eigenvalue, that even though you'd be able to reconstruct your original data, it's not clear that that would help you to do classification later. Can you see how that would work out?
Sure. I mean, like, it just could be that that's not where the information is about what the labels ought to be.
Right. So imagine, for example, that one of your original dimensions is, in fact, directly related to the label, and all the rest are just, say Gaussian noise, but that the variance of that particular direction is extremely small.
It might end up throwing it away.
It'll almost certainly end up throwing it away, which means you'll end up with a bunch of random data that doesn't actually later help you do classification. And that's because this looks a lot like, if I can do the analogy, a filter method.
I was going to say that, yeah.
Yeah, so this is kind of like filtering. And in fact, it's going to turn out that the other two algorithms we look at too are like filtering, although their particular criterion might be more relevant. We'll see. Okay? All right, so do you understand principal components analysis? Again, I'm not asking you to understand exactly how you would run a principal components analysis algorithm. That stuff's in all the text, but just to sort of understand exactly what it is it's trying to do, what it's trying to accomplish.
I think so. So it's taking the data, it's finding a different set of axes that are just like regular axes in that they're mutually orthogonal, but it lines up the variance of the data with those axes so that we can drop the least significant ones, and that gives us a way to do feature selection. But the whole thing is a feature transformation algorithm in the sense that it first moved the data around to be able to do that.
That's exactly right. So you do transformation into a new space where you know how to do filtering.
Got it.
Excellent.